Rejoice in the Lord always. I say again, rejoice. Today, as I said, we've reached past the halfway point of Advent. We're taking that breath of air, kind of that foretaste of what we're going to be celebrating, the joy of having the Lord come into our lives. I want to start with a little bit of a story. The last 7 years of my life, I've been in seminary before I became a priest. And the seminary is a wonderful place that, filled with both Miami and Boynton Beach, each have now over 100 men who are there to be formed spiritually, pastorally, mentally, in all aspects, to be priests for the church, for the people, for Jesus Christ. A beautiful place, but that also doesn't mean they don't have a little bit of fun there. There was one day that me and one of my friends, we were going out shopping, getting a few of the things we need, when something on the clearance rack caught our eye. Perhaps most important was its price, that it was marked at even the seminarian affordable price of $3. But what it was this set of Disney princess bed sheets. As we saw it, we kind of locked eyes, and both you could see in the eyes of, we can come up with something to do with these bed sheets for $3. And so we bought it with all our other things, and we went back. Now there's another guy who's in seminary with us, and this guy, when you think like macho guy, like it's a picture of him in your head right now. You all already know what he looks like. Big guy, works out all the time, got this big Viking beard. Macho guy. And so we waited until he was out. We knew he was going to be out. We snuck into his room. I see you see where this is going. So we see his bed, and his bed is exactly what you would expect. Just the comforter on there is just a plain dark brown color. It's a very just manly, plain looking bed. So we peel back the comforter, and that's when we get our first surprise. He doesn't actually have any sheets on there right now. Say, all right, it's weird, but it's not going to mess up our plan. So we put these sheets on. And as we open it up, we see these sheets are even better than we thought. Not only do they have these Disney princesses all over, and they're the color pink of about this vestment I'm wearing today, but all over is this nice blue script writing of things like, one day my prince will come. And I dream of Prince Charming. Things like that, so we're like, perfect. Put it on there. We make his bed back up, and we sneak away, our plan complete. So that night, we wait, say, we're going to get a good reaction. That night goes by, and nothing. We think, well, maybe he was just really tired, turned the lights off, went to bed. Tomorrow morning, next morning comes and nothing. The next day, nothing. And you know, every day we're in classes with this guy. We sit right next to him in mass every day. We're kind of, peace be with you. Like, it's today. Like, maybe he knows and he's just like somehow found out it was us and it's just silently plotting one day it's going to get us. But as time goes by, like weeks go by and nothing happens. And a little over a month after we did it, is when he finally goes, who did this? Like, what? Who went in my room? And by this time, we'd almost forgotten. We're like, what? Oh! And it turns out, because he didn't have sheets on his bed, he had just been sleeping on top of the comforter. Oh! So he didn't want to mess up the mattress. And so it took almost a month for him to move around enough for this, the comforter, to show the sheets underneath. So that's when we got maybe the bigger surprise, that he goes, it's funny, but I didn't have any sheets. You guys bought me sheets, thank you. Incentive for me to make my bed every day. Because if anyone comes in here, like the dean of men or the rector of the seminary comes in, I don't want them knowing I have Disney princess sheets. So now I'll make my bed every day. So how does this tie into the gospel? I'm going to do it. When we come upon John the Baptist today, in the gospel in the beginning, there's people coming to him and saying, what should I do? What am I supposed to do to live a good life? And he's giving them each different kind of advice. He gives the general. He says, well, if you have two cloaks, share one. And if you have extra food, do the same. And then the tax collector. And tax collectors were infamous at this time for taking extra, for taking taxes, and then lining their own pockets and getting a bit more. And so he says to them, don't take extra. Take only what you're supposed to collect. And to the soldier, don't extort money from them. But all of this, while it's very good and it's personal for these people, it's kind of generic, be a good person type stuff. Every religion in the world, and even those who don't follow a religion, kind of agree you should be a good person. If you're able to give and help out other people, you should give. But for us, that becomes, for the world, it becomes our ground comforter. That thing that we know anyone can look at, and it's going to look good. It's not going to embarrass us. It's not going to be weird to anyone. I'm a good person. I've made my bed. It looks good. It looks manly. It looks proper. But then he's dealing with, well, he's saying all these good things. Maybe John the Baptist is the one we've been waiting for, the Savior, the Christ. And so they ask him, are you the one we're waiting for? He right away says, no, no, not me. There's one coming after me, who I'm not even worthy to remove his sandals. Now at that time, people recognized him as a prophet. A prophet of God was the highest you could get. And so for a prophet to say, one is coming who I'm not worthy to take off the sandals, that's a slave job. There's someone coming who I'm not worthy to be a slave for. That's saying something. What's he say he's going to do when he comes? Kind of uses language we don't get of a winnowing fan and threshing floor. That's where when farmers would take in the wheat, they would have this threshing floor where they would put, it wasn't just the wheat, it also had all this extra plant stuff that they didn't want. And then they'd take a pitchfork and throw it up in the air, and other people with a fan would be fanning, so it would blow away the extra dried out plant stuff. And just the good wheat would fall to the floor. So he's saying that's what Jesus is going to do in our hearts. That he is going to come into our hearts, not just baptizing with water, but with the Holy Spirit and with fire. He's going to set a fire in our hearts to burn out, to winnow away, to get rid of all the chaff, the bad stuff, the extra that's in there, and leave just the good. But if we're going to trust Jesus to do that, if we trust that there's more than just the good stuff going on, if there's actually Jesus inside of us doing the action, it doesn't say that Jesus has come and you're going to do this for him and he'll oversee it. It says he will actually do that for us. But that takes faith. That takes trust that he's going to be doing something inside. And it's just like every sacrament that we celebrate. And when we come forward and receive the Eucharist, what do we see? What do we taste? Bread, wine. Anyone who just walked in the door who wasn't Catholic would just see bread and wine and think that was that. But we know because of his words that there's more to it. And on the outside, there's that ground comforter, that food that we know. And food and drink, what does that do? It gives us sustenance. It gives us the strength to do what we need to do. But if you peel that back, you look deeper at the joy, at the excitement that's inside of it. You find God. You find the words. This is my body and this is my blood. There is so much joy and love inside that container. That's not even what it looks like, the bread and the wine. In baptism, we pour water. We use water every day to clean ourselves, to wash off the dirt. If you peel back that layer, you find a spiritual cleansing. It goes deeper. It wipes away our very sins and makes us children of God, priest, prophet, and king for God. When couples come for marriage, what you see is two people making a promise, saying, I'll be together for as long as I live. And if you could put on the spiritual goggles, if you could pull back that brown, safe comforter, what you see people, two people, two flesh, becoming one flesh in the Lord,
and the Lord witnessing that and saying, the two of you together are now one. You still look like two, but I see you as one person coming towards me. You more resemble the Trinity in that you are now two persons whose love can give birth to another, can give birth to children, to represent that Trinitarian love. That's what's underneath what we see in marriage. When I was ordained, what you would have seen is just a man lying on the floor. It's ridiculous if that's all that there is. But if you have faith that on the interior, the Holy Spirit was coming down to change my very soul, to make it so that when I call down the Holy Spirit, I ask one of the persons of the Trinity, I call down God and God listens when I say, make this bread and wine into your body and blood because I'm doing what Christ asked me to. There is so much more going on, so much more reason for joy. But for ourselves, it's not enough to just always show the world that brown comforter, that safety of I'm a good person. When I have extra, I do good things and I don't extort money from people. I don't get extra money on top of what I want or what I have. Sometimes we have to peel back that comforter and show the Disney princess sheets that is Jesus' love pouring forth from us, the personality, the joy, the love. Because what that is doing inside of us is allowing us to do something that no human can do. Humans can love, but it's an imperfect love. It's a love that's tainted by sin, that's tainted by our own desires, a selfishness, a fall. But what God allows us to do when he sets our hearts afire, when he burns away the chaff and the extra within us, as we trust him to do, then something different happens. We're not just loving with a human love. We're loving with the love that is God's love. That is God, a love that is beyond what any of us could do alone. But to do that, we have to have faith that there is something under that brown comforter, and that it does have a joy within it, something that gives us the reason to go out, to put on, the courage to put on pink. This is my first Galate Sunday. This is my first time going into that vestry and actually pulling out the pink, and it's a little scary. To put on something like this and go in front of everyone. I mean, I pull it off, but that's the the reason we do this is because it's reflecting what's going on inside of us. It's going past that external layer and peeling it back and showing the joy and the love that we have in our hearts, that we don't have to every day make our bed perfectly so no one can see what's going on within us, but that we can occasionally show what's going on. Even though it can be scary, even though it can be embarrassing, that we have reason to rejoice. We have reason to love, and that is the love of God and the fact that our Savior has come into the world. He did it 2,000 years ago, and he's going to come again, and we can have trust and faith in that. And because we have trust and faith in that, we have reason to rejoice, to love, to do our second reading said today, and rejoice always in the Lord. I say again, rejoice.